Classroom Under the Sea is made possible through the generous support of Diversity in Aquatics, the project's official sponsor. To learn more, please visit diversityinaquatics.com. Additional support for this episode comes from the Atlantic Ranger Scuba Club. Classroom Under the Sea is presented by the Marine Resources Development Foundation on Key Largo in the Florida Keys, and Roane State Community College, one of Tennessee's community colleges.
Hi.
Neil. Jan, welcome to Jules Undersea Lodge.
Good morning. Hope you had a good night.
Yep. Neil and Jan are going to join us for Classroom Under the Sea right after this.
Welcome to Classroom Under the Sea. I'm Bruce Cantrell from Roane State Community College, and we're broadcasting live from Jules Undersea Lodge in Key Largo, Florida. Because we are broadcasting live from an underwater habitat, there may be some background noise. That's just the sound of our life support systems. If you'd like to make comments or ask questions during today's program, you can contact us on Twitter at hashtag Classroom Under the Sea or on our Classroom Under the Sea Facebook page. Today we're going to be talking about the history of man in the sea. We have three very special guests with us. We've got Bob Barth. Bob is a former Navy diver. He's an aquanaut and a veteran of both the U.S. Navy's Genesis program of the 1950s and 60s and of the 1960s U.S. Navy Sealab program. We also have Ian Koblick. Ian is the founder and the president of the Marine Resources Development Foundation and a veteran aquanaut of both the Tektite missions and La Chalupa of the 1960s and 70s. We also have Dr. Neil Monney. Dr. Monney, for 11 years, was a professor and the director of the Department of Ocean Engineering at the U.S. Naval Academy in Annapolis, Maryland. Thank you, gentlemen. We appreciate you being here. But before we get started, we managed to catch up with Bob Barth up in his home in Panama City, Florida. So let's hear what Bob has to say.
I had a lot of questions about what happens to a human body when you put it under pressure and feed them O2 or helium and oxygen all the time. What does living under pressure around the clock going to do to the body? So we embarked on a program that George Bond labeled Genesis. And that took off in 1957. Initial studies that they did were on laboratory animals. All kinds of studies. Ended up with the last animals that we used were goats. And we pressurized these goats, kept them under pressure in a chamber for a week or two. Ran them down, I think, 200 feet, and then got permission from the Navy to put humans in there, which was what this was all about in the first place. In order for me to get a point across to you as far as how Sealab got started, we wanted to get somebody on the ocean floor and leave them there. Putting them in a chamber tells us very little. The people in Panama City at the Navy base there were very eager to be involved in this. They said, we got some old junk. We ended up taking these two pontoons, we call them, cut them up, welded them back together, and made what you see today as Sealab 1. We put together Sealab 1 from scrap. We had a very low budget. We did it on a shoestring, and I mean, we stole more than we bought. And Sealab 3 was made from Sealab 2, but that's another story down the road.
Neil, we've heard what Bob had to say. Can you kind of pick it up from there and bring us up to date from those early days to where we get to the point where Jessica Fain and I can actually live in an underwater habitat for 73 days?
Okay, how did we get here? As a person dives from the surface of the ocean to greater depths, the compressed air or mixed gases that he or she is breathing is absorbed into the bloodstream and then into the body tissues. What the Sealab program proved was that once you reach a saturated state, which takes about 24 hours at the depth where the habitat is, you can stay indefinitely and the decompression time remains the same. So if you're at 100 feet, the decompression time is about 24 hours. If you're at 300 feet, it's about 3 days. And you can stay an hour, a week, or a month, and that decompression time stays the same.
Jan, building on what Neil said, now that we understand saturation diving, how can we use that information for what ocean explorers all over the world are trying to do today?
Well, once the Navy had shown that men could live for long periods of time on the bottom of the sea, the question is, what can you do with it? And it just so happened that NASA was looking for a way to test long-duration outer space missions. They were getting ready to send people to space for 60 days in a program called Skylab. They didn't know how to do this. So the concept of building a space station that you put in the ocean and putting people down there so that NASA could test for physiological changes that might take place, for the psychological changes that might take place, the crew compatibility. And the other scientific questions that they had about how your blood might change and so forth. So they went to the General Electric Company, who agreed to build a space station that they put in the water. And they built it. It was called Tektite 1. But they didn't know, what are we going to do down there for 60 days? And who's going to go down? Let's get scientists. They can work in the ocean and do marine biology. And so the Tektite project was made and begun. The testing for physiology was a real pain in the nose, as you can see here. And it continued throughout the whole 60-day program with all kinds of vital signs being studied. But the science program turned out to be really special. We were able to take water samples at depth and then bring them back to the habitat and test them. And we found that when you tested the water, the chemistry and the physics of it, physiology, that there were differences than when you studied on the surface. We also did all kinds of coral monitoring, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. One of our projects was a lobster study. We went out and captured the lobsters, brought them back to the habitat, measured them, labeled them, and put a little tag on that we could follow with a sonic gun. And we would follow these lobsters day and night using rebreathers. Every once in a while, we'd end up with a surprise. Here you see the diver following a lobster that has been obviously eaten by a shark. But the project ended. At the end of that project, I had become really convinced that this was the way of the future for scientists. This is the way that man was going to explore the ocean, by living and working in it. But it was important that the habitat be changed to meet the needs of the scientists. A space habitat just didn't have a lot of the features you needed. It took a whole team of Navy engineers to sink it and put it on the bottom. Here's a little drawing that shows all the steps that you had to go through in order to get this habitat to the bottom of the sea, and it took weeks. It had to be ballasted. Next, by hand, and that took several days. So the project was a disaster when it came to operating for science use. The bottom of the habitat, the bottom of the seafloor, had to be changed and flattened and leveled and
Dr. Monney here is one of the people that was in charge of doing that. Also, if you look here at this, go back, please. If you look here at the windows, you'll see that they're great big bubbly windows. Well, this was a potential problem because if someone dropped a wrench from the service, they could break the windows. I became so involved in this, I became a program manager and an aquanaut, and I started writing down all the things that were wrong. And I decided that we could make a better habitat. So this is the habitat that we came up with. It's called La Chalupa. And everything was inside a barge so it would be safe from the sea. And next slide. It was easy to ballast. It was just towed out to sea, filled with water, went to the bottom, and you were ready to go to work. Next. It was an actual boat. So it didn't have to be loaded on anything. Just a boat came and picked it up, towed it and its support buoy, which was the little boat that you see there. That boat contained all of the necessary water and power and air to support the bottom mission. We didn't have to connect to the shore. The habitat, next. The tektite habitat had a very dangerous aspect in that it was very difficult to get into it. You had to swim through a tunnel, and if there was anything blocking the entrance, like the daily delivery of the barrel line and supplies, no divers could get in. Next. Here's the barrel line being brought up into the chamber. Next. In the habitat that we designed, there was plenty of room for not only divers to get in and out, but also to be able to bring in your supplies and not get interfered. Here's how much room there was. The divers could move around in there, fill their tanks. Next. Another picture of the divers in there coming in from a dive, having their tanks filled without even getting out of the water. And then here's a resupply. We didn't have a big chamber. It's just a small pot. It made everything work very easily. The resupplies were simple. The boat could be moved to any location within a matter of hours. And at the end of a mission, the divers did not have to leave the habitat. They stayed in the habitat. Safety divers opened the door, and you were able to sit in there and do your decompression within the habitat. But this program was the last of the really operational habitats in the 70s. All interest in the ocean went away, and there was no more support. So the habitat program was closed down, and we waited to see what would happen.
We're going to talk a little bit more in a minute about the progression from then, when the habitat program was shut down, to kind of what I see as a resurgence in habitats today. So Neil, if you want to pick that theme up where Jan left off, talk to us a little bit about your involvement over the years and bring us up to date.
Okay. At the same time that the tektite program was underway, I was invited by the Naval Academy to come and develop their new ocean engineering program. What you're going to see here in the next slide is a, you can move that when you're ready there. Okay. What you see there is a cutaway artist rendering of an underwater laboratory. I thought that it would be a really good program to have the midshipmen, the students in the ocean engineering program, actually design the different aspects of this undersea habitat, looking at the materials and the life support and the structure. And they did that over a period of a number of years. We formed design teams, and we'd have a competition in each class, and then we'd pick the one that was the best. And then after several years of this, we actually had a comparison of all of the winning selections, and we got approval to actually build the undersea laboratory. And they named it Medusa. It was completed. That whole program took about 10 years. And at the end of that time, with the next slide here, I was able to have it donated to the Marine Resources Development Foundation. And here you see it sitting in a shipyard down in Fort Lauderdale. It has its new paint job. And it's interesting, if you look in the background there, in the lower right-hand corner, you'll see the Chalupa Laboratory, which had been placed in dry dock at the same shipyard. Now, there were two fundamental differences between the Medusa, which was renamed the Marine Lab, and the La Chalupa. The Marine Lab was small enough that it could be lifted by a crane and put on a barge and towed to where it was going to be placed. And also there was an air flow-through system rather than using the barreline to absorb the CO2. Here you just replenish the air, and as long as you were at a shallow enough depth, there was no problem from breathing the compressed air. It's like taking a glass and holding it upside down underwater and then pushing it down in the water column. The air is actually compressed, and you'll see the water level rising up. Well, the air is flowing into the habitat and going out the entrance, and that's keeping the air-sea interface right at the hatch level. Another really interesting aspect of this is that the scientists and doctors learned that there were medical benefits from breathing oxygen under pressure or compressed air, and the body heals faster. And right now there's a very serious consideration about the fact that it appears to also heal the brain, so that people with concussions improve pretty dramatically if they're exposed to that environment. Next slide. And here we have the Marine Lab being launched. You see that it had its own contained ballast, and it floats with about a foot and a half to 2 feet of freeboard, and then it is winched down into place on the bottom or whatever depth that you want to operate it at. And now you're looking at it where it was placed in the same lagoon. It's about 100 feet away from where we are right now. And you're looking out the viewport with a student and an instructor there at the table. And here you're looking in the same viewport. There's the instructor at the table and students in the background. There was a very unique feature of the Marine Lab. Next slide. And that was the transparent acrylic sphere. This sphere was developed by the Navy to be a transparent undersea vehicle, and we were able to get one of the spheres that had been developed during the test program and incorporated into the habitat. And there's a student sitting inside with a 360 degree view around under the habitat, looking out, you know, at whatever's happening with the fish or other experiments or students. And the final slide here of the Marine Lab is shows two students looking in through the viewport again. Now, you notice that I've spoken about students and instructors, because that's what the Marine Lab was intended for and used. Jan earlier had mentioned that there was a declining interest in the ocean programs, and really, our interest in the ocean was mankind was doing that was harming it, and we wanted to call attention to the importance of safeguarding the marine environment. So recall that you saw the chalupa sitting at that shipyard. We were able to purchase that for a very reasonable price because it wasn't being used, and we converted it into Jules Undersea Lodge. And here you see that. That's a cutaway artist rendering of the habitat that we're in right now. And we took the chalupa, which on the interior looked like a World War II submarine, and converted it into really quite a very comfortable living area. It had to be supported from shore. And here you see the command van. And in this lagoon are both the Marine Lab and Jules Undersea Lodge. And the watch officer can monitor both of the habitats and also communicate with people that are in it. And this is a shot, a photo of the inside of Jules Undersea Lodge. And where you see the two people sitting by the viewport, well, that's the same viewport where we're sitting right now. And the fellow in the foreground there is a shot of me when I was considerably younger than I am now. Next slide. And this is taken from about the same position as the last photo. You're looking the other direction now at the galley and the food preparation area. And finally, this is the sign on the Undersea Hotel, and that's how we got to be where we are now. And Bruce?
Thanks, Neil. We appreciate that. Our social media is starting to generate a lot of questions and a lot of comments. Before we get to those, Jan, just a couple of questions here. As Neil pointed out, we are sitting in La Chalupa. Jules Undersea Lodge is La Chalupa. At the time, it was the most sophisticated underwater habitat in existence, and in my opinion, it still is. Can you tell us how many underwater habitats are there in the entire world today, and where are they at? What are they doing?
Well, the total number is three, and two of them are here in the lagoon, and one of them is about 7 miles offshore from. So Key Largo has the world's total number of undersea habitats that are operating today.
Only three. We have two of them in the lagoon, the yes. Marine Lab. We have La Chalupa here, and then Aquarius Reef Base off the coast. Why do we need underwater habitats? Why do you think we should get back involved in trying to live and work under the sea?
An underwater habitat provides you with an undersea base from which you can work. And what's required for a base like that are a couple of things. A very intensive biological survey of a small area, about 1,000 feet by 1,000 feet. And second, to do really sophisticated marine archaeology. It's never been done before by a habitat. The reason that this is such a unique opportunity is because once you live in the habitat and become familiar with your surroundings, you're much more at ease when you're working outside. It's not a matter of getting out of a boat and bouncing around, getting to the bottom, getting your orientation, getting to your location, doing your work, looking at your watch, making sure that your time isn't up, and then getting out. You go out just like you'd go to work at home. You do your job, you get tired or cold, go in, have a cup of coffee, look out the window, think about what you're going to do next, and go on back out. It can only be accomplished by being situated right next to your job site.
Yeah, I can understand what you're saying there, because with Jessica and I living in Jules now for our 73 days, we're very familiar with the lagoon, and we can just put on our equipment. We can go out, for instance, to clean the windows. Things get dirty over time, and you have to have the maintenance. And I can see how that would be advantageous, say, if you're an archaeologist working a wreck, for instance, instead of doing a bounce dive down and staying 10, 15 minutes and then having tremendous amount of decompression going up. I can see how it would be advantageous.
It allows you to be able to focus on your job and not about your timing. How much time do you have down? Are you in the right spot? You already know the place intimately, and you just go out and go right to work.
I'm going to turn to a couple of questions here that we've received over the social media. Neil, I'll start this one off for you. This is a question that we get quite often. When people hear that Jessica and I are going to be down here for 73 days and we're trying to break the world record for living and working under the sea, the first question a lot of people ask is, well, what about those people on a submarine? They go out there and they dive deeper and they stay longer period of times. Why don't they have the record? What's the difference between what you're doing and what the submariners are doing?
Well, you know, that's a good question. The submarine environment is one atmosphere. So they're breathing the same air at the same pressure as they are when they're on the surface. And that's fundamentally different than breathing as a diver, because here we're breathing compressed air. When we put on our dive gear and go out to do our work, you know, we're staying at that same pressure, and of course we can go down or up. We can't come back to the surface because we'd have to decompress more slowly after we were down there and became saturated at that depth. But the advantage of that, as John was saying, is that wherever you are, you can spend a great deal of time doing the work that you wanted to do. I was an aquanaut on one of the La Chalupa missions. We averaged more than 8 hours a day in the water for 2 weeks conducting our research programs. I was testing a comparison of the strength of a marine sediment. If you measured the strength on the bottom, you know, and brought the sample back and measured it inside the lab, compared to having it brought up from the bottom and then tested on the surface. Then you get a disturbed sample and you're not really getting a true indication of the strength of the sediment.
So back to the submarine question. So what we're saying is that a submariner can go on board, but they're staying at the same pressure they are at sea level, no matter how deep they go or how long they stay, and then when they come back up, they just walk off the submarine with no decompression.
That's right.
Whereas people who are saturation diving, like Jessica and I are doing now, we've been down here for pushing our first week now, so we are saturated, that is, we've absorbed all the nitrogen we can in our body for this depth at this pressure. Mm-hmm. So if we just want to pop back up to the surface and go fly on an airplane or something, we could have very serious medical consequences.
Right. From this depth, as long as you're breathing out on the way up, you'd be okay while you're on the surface. But you would want to wait for 8 to 10 hours before you flew, because that's even less pressure. And then you could get bubbles that would be coming out of solution in your bloodstream and possibly lodging in a place that could cause serious problems. So people that live here, we, you know, that come down and stay here and are saturated, we caution them not to fly. They know they're not supposed to fly until the next day.
So even though we're living right now at about 24 feet where we're sitting mm-hmm. now, over a period of time, we could have a lot more medical consequences than a submariner who might take his boat down to several hundred feet and come back up.
Oh, yeah. Actually, at this depth, you know, you can come to the surface. Your body can handle
right.
that. But we're right about at the optimum depth there. If you go much further, you know, if you went down to 35, 40 feet, then you would have to decompress. Or if you were down at 100 feet, Chalupa worked at 100 feet.
Jan,
10 miles yeah. off the coast.
Jan, you want to jump in on that?
Well, you will be decompressing and outgassing
yes.
for about 24 hours.
Right.
And the first 12 hours are going to be fairly significant outgassing. So you're right about the flying. The 24-hour period, you're fine after 12 hours. We'd have 24 hours as a safety
right.
Thing. But you'll you are seriously saturated and will take a while to decompress, but you don't have to go in a chamber to decompress at this depth. If we were a few feet deeper,
just a few feet,
we'd have you locked up for 24 hours more.
And one of the reasons we're breathing compressed air, of course, everybody saw you all come in the moon pool there. What's keeping the water out? Why isn't the water just flooding us here? It's open to the sea.
Well, Neil was explaining earlier, or his explanation was, if you take a glass of water, you turn it upside down, or you take a glass and put it in a bucket of water, you push it down and the air stays at a pressure. That pressure is equal to the depth. What we do is we pump air into here so that the pressure inside here is equal to the pressure where the water level is. And you are living at that depth pressure, which right now is 22 and a half feet.
And without getting too technical, Neil, based upon the partial pressure gas laws, when we go to that pressure, a higher amount of nitrogen is being forced into our system and gets dissolved there and wants to sit there, and we don't want to shake it up and force it out fast.
That's right. Yeah, and your body can handle the pressure change from going to this depth to the surface. The gas won't come out as bubbles in your bloodstream or tissues. As John was saying, much deeper than that, and it would, you would actually have to decompress over a longer period of time.
Speaking of decompression, John, this question's for you. I've been sitting here just dying to ask you this. We got another question off the social media there. Basically, they're saying, what does decompression feel like? When you're decompression, are you getting sick? Do you start feeling weird? What happens to you until you finally get that nitrogen out and you become reacclimated to the surface?
The answer is no. There is no physical feeling that you have. During decompression, when you're fairly deep, you have stops. And on those stops, when you get closer to the surface, then you change gas to oxygen to try to flush your system faster. And the oxygen gives you a little bit of a refreshed feeling. But none of it is either painful or uncomfortable.
Go ahead, Neil.
I was going to interject something there. You know, that's why the La Chalupa laboratory works so well, because as an aquanaut, you were inside this chamber under pressure while the structure was brought to the surface, and then you were towed back into port. During that time, Don said you have stops at different pressures, but really you were just in here and the pressure was lowered to each of those stops, and this became the decompression chamber itself, instead of coming up and then going into another decompression chamber on the surface.
That's pretty much the way the Aquarius Reef base works today, right? At the end of a mission, they decompress
no,
into...
No, yes and no. Yes, they decompress in Aquarius, but Aquarius never leaves the bottom.
Correct.
So then
yep.
They have to recompress, lock out, and then go to the surface, which is a lot riskier if there's anything wrong than slowly decompressing with never having to get out of the chamber and not leaving that chamber until it's on the surface and you have fully decompressed, and then you just get out and go about your business. You don't have to recompress and then decompress again.
You know, back in the day, the early days of space, you had to meet a lot of qualifications to qualify as an astronaut. But now that the space exploration is moving toward the private industry, they're looking at regular people going up into space, being allowed to do that, which will generate money for the research. And that's a new thing in space. Beyond what you've done with La Chalupa, you've been doing that since the mid-1980s. Back in the 60s, the research and the work that I've done studying the history, back in the 60s, you had to be pretty qualified to be considered to be an aquanaut. But now, in the 1980s, what you've done is started opening up this world to regular people. You want to talk about that a little bit?
Only scientists lived in the sea up until 1986, 84 with Medusa.
Oh, yeah, and, that's right.
And then when we got the Medusa habitat, the marine lab habitat down here, it was the first time that students would be able to go in the ocean and experience what we had experienced so much. And that happened in 1984. In 1986, we expanded to non-students and non-scientists, to anybody. Recreational divers, to have them experience what it's like to live and work in the sea, to experience the closest thing you can do to being in outer space is what we're doing right here today, living under the sea.
And we'll point out, as you mentioned earlier, there's only three underwater habitats. Now, Marine Lab, people just can't jump in the lagoon and go to Marine Lab. It's, you know, that's where we're doing research over there. Aquarius is deeper, it's further off the coast, and a stay in the Aquarius, you have to book time so far in advance, you have to get your mission approved and everything else. So what you've got here, allowing everyday people to come down, live in an underwater environment, it's pretty unique. It's the only game in town.
You know, I had actually intended to mention that
here's a good time.
When we built this, the intent was to have people around the world, from anywhere in the world, be aware that they could actually come here and live underwater. It was to change the perception that people have about the ocean and look at this as an environment that was really important to them. Not just to live in, but to maintain the integrity of it.
Yeah, our own State Community College, we've been bringing students down here now for several years, and the select students get to spend the night in the water, underwater habitat, and we can talk to them and we can explain it, we can show the pictures, we can show the movies. But until you pop up in the moon pool, people will pop up in the moon pool and they'll look around and their first expression is, this is nothing what I expected, this is cool. Mm-hmm. And you've had some quite notable figures that have stayed here as well, right?
I certainly have.
You want to mention any?
Well, we've had Cousteau stay down here, Jean-Michel.
We've had Steve Tyler, who said he composed a song while he was down here. So we've had, from the entertainment world and the scientific world as well, people from all over the world. I mean, we've had people from Japan and...
Prime Minister of Canada,
Trudeau. That Trudeau was down and stayed here for, he became an aquanaut. We define an aquanaut as a person that spends at least a day living underwater.
Yeah, you know, that I've always found that strange, that in NASA, once you meet the qualifications, you're an astronaut, but you don't have to go up into space. But to become an aquanaut, you have to, I can't just say, well, I'm going to do it someday, I'm an aquanaut. You have to actually do it. Well, of all the people who stayed here, John, the one that fascinates me the most was a program you had in the 90s, I think it was, the Man in the Sea project, and you had that in conjunction with former astronaut, Mercury 7 astronaut, Scott Carpenter, and you actually communicated here with a historic communication. You want to mention that?
As the shuttle was passing over the state, we talked through mission control to Mike Gernhardt, who's going to be our next week's speaker, about how we use sea of space. And Scott Carpenter, who is one of our board members and a very good friend of ours, we did this program right from where you're sitting, and we were talking to the space shuttles that went over.
Now, the monitor's showing that now.
Yep.
There you are.
Who's that guy on the right there with the dark hair and beard? Neil, we got another question here from our social media that says, it's a good question. You know, we're all down here right now. Jess and I are going to be down here after you all leave. What happens if the surface pump pressure stops working? I assume the lodge would flood. Is there an emergency escape? If things start happening, stop working, and we start taking on water, what are we going to do?
Well, you know, that's really one of the safest aspects of this particular underwater habitat. You have literally hours before the water would creep up to a level that would bother you, and there's ample oxygen already here.
So it's not just going to come rushing in the middle of the night?
No, you'd have to have a failure up at a higher level to have the water come gushing in. That's not going to happen. This was designed for 100 feet. Actually, it could go down to 200 feet easily and operate. But even if it did happen, you have very good access to that moon pool. All you have to do is take your regulator, go in the water, and then just go up to the surface and yes, slowly. You'd be fine.
And we have several emergency cylinders sitting out there. That brings up a good point, which leads into another point. We're down here. We're sitting nice and comfortable. You know, Jess and I have been down here almost a week. We've got another 9 weeks to go. But we're not down here alone. On topside, for every second we're down here, there's somebody up topside in the control module watching our back. You want to talk about what they're looking for up there and what they're monitoring just so we can stay down here and have fun?
Are you sure they're up there?
I'm hoping.
Well,
they call us every now and then and say, hey, I'm on duty now.
They're there. And it's a safety watch. And we don't expect them to have to do anything, but we're there 24/7. But I was going to mention something. You were talking about what happens if.
Mm-hmm.
When this habitat operated offshore, we did the safety analysis before we put it together. And there were analyses such as, what if you're on the bottom and we were offshore all by ourselves?
10 miles.
And a Russian submarine, which were traveling to Cuba up through the Mona Passage, came and ran into a window. What would happen? Well, it would flood immediately. So if you notice that the ports, the little things on the sides of the walls in this habitat are real up high, they're above the window. The communication system radio was on the roof, so that even if the window was broken, you would have a bubble of air in here, so your communications would still work and you could call for help. So we went through these scenarios down to things that were as ridiculous as that sounds, but if you don't look at them all, you have accidents. We have operated this now since 1972. And it has been an incredible operation.
One of the questions that comes to mind is, if that had had a catastrophic failure, like a submarine running into it, and you were on the continental shelf out there, you can't come right to the surface because you would die very quickly once you
gets back into
there.
The saturation.
So they had escape pods, two escape pods on top of the habitat. And from my perspective, when I was an aquanaut, that was the toughest part of the training because three of us had to get in this rather small escape pod. You squeezed in with three people, and you had to manipulate the valves on that so that it came free from the top, and then you removed the water from it, and it floated to the surface and had a radio beacon, and then they came and picked you up, took you back to a decompression chamber back in port, 10 miles away. I'm claustrophobic enough that if I were wedged into that, I don't know that I might have stayed and taken my chance.
So you have three divers packed in like sardines, flooded with water, and you got to get there and then force the water out, and hopefully you're going to float to the surface and somebody's going to pick you up and carry you off. We've talked about this a lot. You're very familiar with the programs of habitats, what I call the golden age, back in the 60s and 70s. And when you conceptualize and you design and you built the habitat we're in now, you took a lot of the what I call mistakes or oversights from the other habitats, and you eliminated it from this habitat, which makes it nice and neat, such as the moon pool, such as a flat port as opposed to a bubble port. You want to... Some of this, for tektite, for instance, to get into tektite.
Well, it it was a, as I said before, it was a space shuttle made to go underwater to keep people to analyze space programs. This, to work in the sea, you had to have something that could be movable, that you could safely decompress, that was safe from things like people dropping wrenches on the windows. And you had to be able to get in and out of it easily. It had to level itself on the bottom. This one is self-leveling. All of those features made it a very special device.
Okay, we have a good question from our good friend Ron Peters at Seawolf Diving, who's been very, very supportive of the program. Ron would like to know, what is the maximum practical operational depth for a ambient pressure habitat?
Well, I'll let you answer that.
Haven't worked on one that I was pushing the limits on. Probably 150 feet is where you want to have an open bottom habitat, and where the divers can work and still work on a nitrogen-oxygen mixture and be doing their diving on air. You start to run into pulmonary problems and oxygen toxicity problems if you get any deeper. We'll leave it at that.
Yeah, okay.
Ron,
yep.
It's 150 feet.
Yeah, you might, well, Ron, I'm sure knows, but when you're operating under that mode with compressed air, what you're doing is you're breathing down the oxygen initially till you reach the same partial pressure of oxygen that you have on the surface. But you're breathing out the carbon dioxide. It's not an air flow through system, so that has to be taken out. And that's where they use the barreline, or the more efficient one is lithium hydroxide, to absorb the carbon dioxide. And you have to keep changing those canisters while you're down.
Don, we mentioned that in the 60, or in the 70s, after La Chalupa, the interest on underwater habitation kind of faded away, and there's a lot of different theories as to what that might have caused that. But in reading the literature, I see a resurgence of interest in underwater habitats. What do you think the future for underwater habitation is?
I would like very much to see a very mobile habitat that could take five divers down to 150 feet and be used on some really serious archaeological projects. I see that as the scientific end. The other aspect is that there may be some recreational undersea hotels or habitats, but I doubt that you would have to swim to them. I think you would enter them from the surface, and there may be a lockout for diving. And I would also like to see that.
Now, I think we've got a very, very big, diverse audience out here. And, of course, we're trying to target the young people to get young people interested in science. If I was on the other side of the screen looking at us, I would not help but be fascinated. Here we have people that are talking and living, and we're broadcasting from under the sea. You know, every now and then a fish swims by behind us here. But you just don't do that, Neil. In order to get to where we're at, you have to conceptualize, you have to do the architecture, you have to do the designing, you have to do the building, you have to do the operation, and then, Jan, in order to live here, you have to be an aquanaut. And there's just, you'd like to say it's open to everybody, but it's not. For instance, if somebody happens to be claustrophobic. So my question is, it's a kind of a roundabout way, but Neil, I'll let you answer, then Jan, I'll pass it over to you. For the young people that are looking at us today and listening to us today, if they wanted to get involved in some aspect, from designing all the way to living in it, like Jess and I are doing today, what kind of advice would you give them as far as studying and working?
Well, this is where the math and the science becomes important, because all of the things that we're doing here to all of the things that were done to provide this environment, keep us alive with the life support systems, all of the considerations required the science and the math to be able to do it. you know, the science gives us the understanding of it. The engineers then take that science and actually come up with the ways to build this. And, you know, that's what my students did in the ocean engineering major at the Naval Academy. So that's what I would, you know, encourage anyone that's interested in this should be doing science and math.
John, real quickly, what can you add to that?
I concur with Neil. It's really, you need to get a good education in science and math and science. I think that because habitats are in the ocean, you need to get a background in science. Well, that's chemistry, physics, and biology, and environmental sciences.
Well, thank you all both. I want to thank you all for tuning in this week and joining us for Classroom Under the Sea. We hope you'll tune in again next Thursday at 1 o'clock, same place, same time, where we're going to talk about the sea and space connection. Our special guests next week are going to be NASA astronauts Buzz Aldrin, the second man to walk onto the moon, and Mike Gerhardt, who's also a NASA scientist, as you heard, or an astronaut, as you heard Jan talk about, has actually communicated in space to right here we're sitting today. I want to thank my special guest today, Ian Koblick, the president and founder of Marine Resources Development Foundation, and Dr. Neil Money. We appreciate you guys coming down for our inaugural broadcast and giving everybody your insight. And you have our gratitude. We thank you very much.
That's a good job.
And on behalf of Jules Undersea Lodge, the Marine Resources Development Foundation, and Roane State Community College, we hope you all have a great day, and we hope to see you here next week.
Classroom Under the Sea is made possible through the generous support of Diversity in Aquatics, the project's official sponsor. To learn more, please visit diversityinaquatics.com. Additional support for this episode comes from the Atlantic Ranger Scuba Club. Classroom Under the Sea is presented by the Resources Development Foundation on Key Largo in the Florida Keys, and Roane State Community College, one of Tennessee's community colleges.